Hey everybody, how you doing? We just wanted to welcome you to Forgiven Church this morning. We are glad that you are joining in with us right now. We love you, we appreciate you, and we are so excited that you're here. So Zach's actually going to open us up with a song, and then we're going to get back in with the word, and then we're going to end up closing with a song today. So God bless you, and we will be back with you in just 1 second. Sure. Are we all good back there still? Awesome. Praise the Lord. Well, like I said, it's great to have you all here at Forgiven Church with us. And I just want to let you know that is a song off of Zach's album, Big Plans, that he just released a few months ago. Do You Trust Me? So in this time that we're in right now, right. We definitely need to be considering that, don't we?
Yep.
Yeah, so awesome. Praise the Lord.
So if you want to order that,
yeah,
you get a hold of Zachary Oshner, yeah, on Facebook and message him. And he's got an awesome album. He's got some, they're really powerful, anointed songs. And so, yeah, and he would love to ship one out to you or whatever. So that'd be awesome.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he actually, last week we were out in California at a conference, at the Rise Conference. There was lots and lots of people there. And Zach was able to sing four of his songs off his album while he was out there too. So it was a big hit, sold lots of albums, so it was a great time. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
All right, first of all, I just want to encourage everybody, for those of you who are watching right now, let us know who's watching. Just go ahead and say hi, Pastor. Let us know where you're from, because we have people watching from all over, whether it's a Bluffton area, Fort Wayne area, people outside of state. Just let us know that you're on. And we also wanted to let you comment too, because we like getting comments and feedbacks and everything else, so you guys can,
amen,
encourage one another while you're here also. So praise the Lord for that. Awesome. First of all, let's take a look at our mission statement if we could, please. All right, our mission statement here at Forgiven Church, we are here to love God, to love others, and to discover and develop the greatness that's within
each
one of us. Amen.
Right.
And there's greatness inside of you. There's
and
greatness
you.
Inside of me.
Yeah.
There's greatness inside of every single one of you that is watching in right now. So if you're with somebody else, just go ahead and tell them there's greatness inside of you right now, whether it's your family or other people that you might be with. Hopefully it's not more than 10, but make sure you let them know there's greatness, because there,
yeah,
there is greatness inside,
true,
of every single person.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Awesome. Well, we're getting ready to get into our word today. So we're going to go through our faith quote, what we do every single week. So let's go ahead and get our faith quote on the screen, and we can all say this together. Here we go. Faith quote is this.
This
is my Bible, and I believe
it was written for me to understand and agree with. I am what it says I am, set free from all the power of the enemy. I will do what it says to do, and I will see that it is reality.
All right.
Amen.
How do you guys know we need to believe the word today? Amen, amen, amen.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
We need to believe the word.
Yes. I know I've been doing a lot of talking already. You got anything you want to say before we get into the word here?
No, not yet.
Not yet?
Not yet.
Okay.
Just that, well, we're glad that you're here, and we just want to, you know, welcome everybody, Forgiven Church people, not Forgiven Church people, because we're all part of the body of Christ.
Yes.
And our goal today is just to bring some more encouragement, some more faith, some more positivity in the midst of all the crap and chaos that's on the news.
Yeah.
Jesus is still on the throne. So
right,
we just want to be a bearer of good news.
Right.
That's what we're doing. So we just want to inspire your faith.
Right.
That's what we're going to do today.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. And this is we're trying to do the best that we can. So we got some things kind of going and working while we're doing with this. So hopefully it's all good on your end.
Yeah.
The sound sounded great when we were here while the song was going on before. And hopefully it sounded great online where you were at also. So here we go. Let's get into the word in Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Beginning in verse 35, it says this. Mark chapter 4, verse 35. And this is a very familiar passage for a lot of people, but it's very important, especially with the season that we're in right now. Mark 4, 35 says this. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, let us go over to the other side. And so I just want to encourage everybody right now. Jesus is saying that to all of us also right now.
Right, right.
Let us go over to the other side. That is the word of the Lord right now. Let us, all of us.
Yeah.
Not some of us, not a few of us, but let us all go over to
plan.
The other side.
That's his
exactly.
plan for everybody, that we all make it through this, not
right.
some fall off or
right.
some die off or someone quit,
mm-hmm.
but that we don't grow weary in
right.
well-doing, and so that we reap on
right.
the other side of this. So
right.
it's a good challenge for our faith.
Right,
yeah.
definitely. And then it says this in verse 36, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat, and there were also other boats with him. And now one thing, isn't that amazing? Look what's happening right now. Right here it says, leaving the crowd behind. We're kind of doing that right now, aren't we? The whole social distancing, we're leaving the crowd behind.
Yeah.
Not because we want to, but just for safety reasons for people, because not everybody's at the same level.
Right.
Now, personally, I believe and we believe we are not afraid of what's going on right now. We are not scared of what's going on right now. I understand the whole social distancing thing and why that's all going on, but I don't believe you're going to catch anything from us or vice versa, because we are trusting God. We went through Psalms 91 on Thursday. And if you haven't watched that yet, I encourage you to go back and look at the video from last Thursday. We went through the 91st Psalm. Very, very, very important that we are trusting God with all this. Amen.
Right. And but so they just left church.
Right.
Pretty much. They're leaving the crowd. So they just left church. And
tell
getting
them
ready.
What was going on before that. Yeah, tell them what was going on.
Well, yeah, like when you read back before this story, Jesus just finished talking to the disciples and he shared the parable of the sower.
Right, right.
And he talked about the word, and when the word goes forth, what kind of ground it lands on. And one of the things he said is, you know, there's some, they hear the word, but then the cares of the world.
Right.
Come and they steal the word.
Right.
Or it says the enemy comes. The devil comes immediately to steal the word that was just sown.
Right, right.
So they just got a message at church about faith. They just came out of an atmosphere of faith where Jesus had been teaching all day on the shore.
Right.
Building faith in them, pouring faith, because faith comes by hearing. So they were getting filled up with faith.
Right.
They are on their way out of church and Jesus just said the enemy will come immediately to steal the word.
Yep.
To steal the word. So we need to pay attention if we've been taught that. As soon as we step outside the doors of our church or our Bible study or our video together, the devil is watching, and the devil hates the word you're getting.
Right.
So don't be shocked.
Right.
And this storm, this thing we're going through, it's just another attempt to steal the word.
Right.
Right.
So leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. And there were other boats with him. So just remember this. See, a lot of people, they always kind of focus that it was just Jesus and his disciples. But no, there were several other boats that came along with them at the exact same time and the same command was for them. Not just his disciples, but let's all get over to the other side. And see, you just need to know, we're all right now in our own little individual boats, so to speak. We've got our own little house, our own little this, our own little boats. But God's plan is for every single one of us to get to the other side.
I just want to go back to church just for a minute. Yeah. And that's why these videos are so important, because God said, don't forsake the assembly.
Mm-hmm.
So notice it said they all went with him.
Right.
They all went with the word. They all went with Jesus. They all stayed with Jesus. So that's why these videos, even the streaming, is very important, because we're assembling. We're not forsaking the assembling. We're doing, we're taking advantage of multimedia.
Technology.
The technology, the era that we're in.
Right.
And, you know, we ought to get online. We ought to participate in these. We ought to, you know, band together, kind of like these boats were. They were going together. They refused to be left behind on the shore. They were going with Jesus. They refused to forsake the assembling. So they assembled on the water. But I just want to, you know, there's Bible right there.
Right.
Go together. Do this thing together.
Right.
Yeah.
Right now. And just like you say, we might be in separate places right now, but we're still one together.
Right.
Both, we're all forgiven church and everybody tuning in.
The body of Christ.
Branch.
We're just joining together. This is awesome.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. And then, so it says this in verse 37. It says, a furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. So a serious squall came up, or a serious storm came up. Amen. I know you got some good stuff on this, so why don't you share some things on this.
If you go back to the original, you know, when you pull out the words, because every word, it's written by the Holy Spirit, and there's a reason he worded it the way he worded it. So when you look it up and it says that, you know, there arose this storm, the meaning of that phrase, there arose, is it's something that takes one off guard or by surprise, or something unexpected. It happens suddenly. It comes into being suddenly. And isn't that just like the virus?
Yep, exactly.
Life is normal. Life is smooth. The waters are smooth. Everything's great. And then suddenly, we didn't expect it. Some people didn't prepare for it. You know, some people didn't heed some kind of warnings, whatever. And then you're paying attention to what you're supposed to be doing. And then suddenly there arises something that they were not prepared for.
Right.
They were not expecting. And we all know what that feels like, even with coronavirus and us being locked in our houses. You know, we were not expecting to be told to go home.
Right.
And that you can't talk to anybody or hang out with anybody, because people, you know, human beings are emotional beings. We need each other.
Right.
So this is really torturous for those of us that cannot be together
right.
in the body of Christ, you know. So right.
we're missing our group hugs. Yeah,
yeah
we're missing,
we
missing
miss
hugging
our people.
On everybody. Yeah,
but
high-fiving.
Yeah, but it just came out of nowhere. It just caught them all by surprise. They were not prepared for it. They didn't have time. Listen, they didn't
right.
have time to word up.
Right.
To pray up,
right.
to get their Bible out, to learn something new about faith. Like you've said before, you said, you know, when you're being attacked in an alley, that's not the time to take up martial arts.
Right.
So Jesus had just prepared them on the shore.
Right. They just had church.
They've gotten the word
right.
before. The word is in them. They are fully equipped.
Right.
And thank God we've been blessed with awesome pastors all over this nation and this world that have taught their people
right.
how to handle a storm or mm-hmm. a tragedy. So here they are. They just got filled up with faith. They just got filled with the word.
Yep.
They're excited. And
yep.
then suddenly
right.
they were not expecting it. And here comes the devil.
Right.
Here comes the devil. And he's trying to derail them.
Right.
Yeah.
So it says here in verse 38, it says, Jesus was in the stern sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, Teacher, don't you care if we drown?
Yeah.
Now I'm just going to be real with you because for those of you who know anything about us, we like just keeping it plain. And you know what? There are a lot of people in the body of Christ right now thinking the exact same thing. God, don't you care? Why are you allowing this? Why is this? Why is that? And they're getting in fear.
Right, right.
And they're actually asking God if you care about us in this situation. And so just as the disciples back then were freaking out, the
mm-hmm.
church today in many areas
yeah.
are freaking
and
out.
And not everybody.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, not everybody.
There's some strong, powerful people that believe the word
right.
and they're doing the word. And
right.
so we're excited about that. It's not everybody, but sometimes you can get weak in your faith, or you know, storms will just bring out what's lacking in you.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So we want to encourage each other, you know, because some people are struggling.
Right.
Everyone's not struggling, but some people are struggling.
Right.
So.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, I know that you've got some really good stuff on this. Some key words that we need to pull out in some of these areas. But like I said, it said that Jesus was asleep. Isn't that something else?
Yeah.
When this storm rose up as suddenly as it did, Jesus was not freaking out. And can I let you know right now? Jesus is not freaking out right now. God the Father's not freaking out. Holy Spirit's not freaking out. And they are our example. So guess what? We too should not be freaking out as people who say we trust God. And our actions should back up what we're saying.
Right.
How many of you guys know you can say you're not freaking out, but it's all over your face? Right, right.
Some Amen. Of us just need to talk to our face,
right.
and that's okay.
Right.
David encouraged himself in the Lord.
Exactly.
So there's no shame if you got to talk to your face
right.
or
right.
slap it around.
Right.
Tell it to get in line. You know, there's just nothing wrong with
hey,
that.
Hey.
You got to take control of your face,
yes,
all right? And if
yes.
anything, it's to help other people so
yeah.
they don't see the panic on your face. Even
right.
if you're feeling it, think of others more highly and get
right.
a hold of your lips.
Right.
And your,
there
okay.
we go. All
so
right.
verse 37, I want to go back there a second because there arose. That's
right.
like a suddenly.
Right.
This is a great storm. And great means very large or enormous. So this wasn't
right.
a normal, because you have to think, these guys in the boats
they're
were fishermen.
Yeah, they're used to it.
So they understood storms. This was their area of expertise, if you will.
Right.
This was their area where something happened in their area of expertise that they were not prepared
that
for.
That they knew how to handle, or
yeah.
they could have, right.
They were not prepared for, and you can be overly confident in yourself, your gifts, your talents,
right.
your abilities.
Right.
And when it hits you in your area of expertise, what happens when it's something beyond anything you've ever faced before?
Right.
Now, when does faith kick in? You know,
right.
you get off of yourself and you get over into faith. But it says that it was an enormous thing. And it says the wind, you know, a storm of wind.
Right.
It wasn't a rainstorm. It wasn't a thunderstorm. I mean, sometimes I've seen pictures where it's thunder and lightning and rain. You know, you
right.
see paintings. That's not what it
right.
says. It says a storm of wind.
Right.
And so that was just something they could feel
mm-hmm.
but not see.
Mm-hmm.
We can't see the virus.
Right.
We could feel the effects of it, but we cannot see the virus, right?
Right, right.
And so it's something that they could feel but
feel
not
the wind.
See.
Right.
The effects, like if you're in a plane, turbulence.
Right.
I don't like it. But when you're in a plane, you can feel the wind.
The turbulence,
you
yeah.
just can't see it, but
mm-hmm.
you can feel the effects of it. So they're in a windstorm, like
right.
a tornado kind of thing. There
Super,
was no
right.
there was Powerful. No rain. There was no thunder and lightning and all this crazy stuff. It was just a windstorm.
Right.
And it said that beat into the boat,
right.
beat up against the boat.
Right.
And
the waves, because of the wind.
Yes,
right.
the waves. And so when I looked up, you know, the original meaning of this, because you have to understand we have an enemy.
Right. This is so powerful.
And the enemy is doing everything he can to keep us from our harvest. We declared at the beginning of this year, Pastor did, and other ministers, that 2020 was a year of harvest, breakthrough, greater glory, greater anointing, greater levels, visions and dreams coming to pass. I've heard several people talk about that for 2020. So the enemy knows what's on the other side. He knows you're on the journey. They were on the water. They were heading to the other side. Jesus said, we need to go. So we're going somewhere. The word already spoke. The assignment, the destiny was already declared. And so they were going there. And then right in the middle of that, the enemy got ticked off because he was trying to prevent them from finishing their course, running their race, and keeping their faith, He's coming immediately to steal the faith that they just heard. And so it says it beat into the waves beat into the boat, and it started to fill up. Well, when you look up that word beat into in the well, King James or the original, it means to pick up and throw over against something, to throw, to cast, to hurl. So this was not a natural storm. This was a demonic being.
It had evil spirit behind it.
A demonic being sent to derail where they were going. And the demonic personality was picking up waves. Picking up the waves of the sea and hurling them at their boat in all directions. So it wasn't just rocking one direction. If you read it, it was from all directions.
Around. All the way around.
And wave after wave was hitting it because a personality, a demonic entity, when you study it, was picking up the waves of the sea and throwing them at that ship, at that boat. So that's what was happening there.
And it wasn't just their boat, it was all the boats. It was all
of them. And so basically all hell was breaking loose.
Literally.
Because hell was angry and trying to stop what Jesus was getting ready to do on the other side. The waves, when you look up, you know, the waves began to beat. So they were thrown against the ship, the boat. And that word waves means a succession of waves, one after another, nonstop, over an onslaught, over and over. Isn't that kind of like the news? Everything you hear is
every
an onslaught, another negative report,
every hour,
another bad thing, another test, another study, another case, another death. I mean, it's over and over, over. Isn't that just like the devil? So it just kind of ticks you off, but that's what was happening. It was a demonic attack. It wasn't just a water storm. That's why the disciples didn't know what to do. This was something they had never. And those kind of hard storms, if you look at the kind that came down and just tore up the whole boat, you know, tried to, happened in the daytime. This was nighttime. It said when the evening they got in the boat. So this was at the end of a day at nighttime.
In
so
the
they couldn't
of the
even
night.
See. And this was so unusual this time of day. Yeah, they just were caught off guard.
Yeah, and it's so important that we understand that, like, when they were going across, Jesus was calm. In the midst of all the hell breaking loose around them, Jesus was sleeping in the boat. Remember, we talked about that on Thursday in Psalms 91.
He who dwells.
He
who reclines and lays back and sits down in the secret place.
Just relax.
You hide out. You hide out in God. Which is what Jesus was doing, who is the Word of God. He is the Word. What was the Word doing? Resting. Because the Word already spoke before the storm. The Word already said, we're going to go to the other side. That Word overtakes any kind of opposition.
Any storm.
It's powerful enough to overcome anything.
Right.
And Jesus, the Word, had already spoken the assignment.
Right.
And the destiny and the end results were going over.
Right.
So the Word was resting.
Right.
Some people want to attack the problem over and over and over and over and over and over. Confess, confess it. Go away. Go away in Jesus' name. Stop, stop in Jesus' name. That's not what the Word did.
Exactly.
The Word said we're going, and he went to
rest. And he rested. Exactly.
Those who keep, you know, he'll keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on him. The Word rested. The disciples who had the Word with them chose not to. It's a choice.
That's huge.
How, your initial response when that wind starts, what do you do? They left the Word alone, closed, on the coffee table.
Just because you have the Bible with you doesn't mean you're living it.
They left the Word on the floor. They left it, they just tossed it on the floor and they left it right there. Didn't even consider it first. They responded first while the Word lay right there on the coffee table.
Exactly. So moving on, it says this. So when they said, teacher, don't you care if we drowned? And like, say, a lot of people are saying that right now. Don't you care if this coronavirus hits us? Don't you care about the economy? Don't you care about all this stuff? How many of you guys know? I'm telling you, God cares. He always cares. You know, he's proven it. But now look what ended up happening. In verse 39, he got up, rebuked the wind and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Right. Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. See, just as fast as this storm that we're in the world, just as fast as this coronavirus came up, I'm here to tell you, it is going to die in Jesus' name. It is going to calm down in Jesus' name.
Suddenly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And look, I'm going to tell you, look, I'm about unity in the body of Christ. I am totally about unity. But I am here to tell you, I've already heard other people, other leaders, they have said this. It's just the beginning of what's to come. It's going to be so bad. It's going to be so horrible. I'm telling you something, it is not.
Right.
I am telling you, just as much as it came up, it's going to go back down. And just as much as the stock market went down, it's going to come back up in Jesus' name.
Yep.
Keep your faith out there.
Amen.
This is a year in Jesus' name. Amen.
And we have
but
to understand
so important
that the epidemic is the fear.
Exactly.
It's not the virus. The
right.
epidemic that's sweeping the world is fear.
Exactly.
That's
the
problem.
Yeah, the virus isn't the problem.
No,
it's the fear.
It's the fear. People are responding to the fear of the thing they can't see.
Right.
And what other people are saying, they're responding to people's words on TV, the specialists, the doctors, the studies. People are responding to that. They haven't even seen physically the virus.
Right.
They're going based off of what media and stuff are telling us.
What ifs?
So the epidemic that's driving this craziness is the fear.
Right.
Which is demonic.
Yeah.
The whole spirit behind the wave after all these bad reports coming to us is
fear
demonic.
Is all evil.
And there's fear attached to it.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so it says, you know, that they awoke him.
Right.
They went to him and said, you know, and it said awoke him. And when you look up that, I like the original because you get a bigger picture of the story. So he's sound asleep. There is no suggestion that Jesus ever intended on getting up and addressing the storm.
Right. Not at all.
Because he'd already spoke on the shore and went to sleep. So he had rested in the word, which was him.
Which was him, right.
And wasn't going to budge. He was sleeping. He was just going to ride this out, let it lull him to sleep. He just left a day of ministry. He was getting ready to minister again. He was taking a nap. He was tired. He
like
was
a baby
human.
Rocking, right.
He was like a human. So he's like, I already spoke the word. Good night. Whatever, I'll wake up. He had no intentions. There was no plan for him to get up.
To deal with the storm.
And it says they woke him, and what that means is they grabbed a hold of him and yanked him to his feet. It wasn't Master Jesus.
It was a severe pull.
Jesus, we know you're sleeping. Right. It was a yank. It says like someone being raised from the dead. Another meaning of that word awake is resurrection.
Right.
They yanked him, like they jerked him up out of his sleep. How many like that? I mean, you're sound asleep, minding your business, and here comes the dog up in your face, and it just jerks you right out of your sleep. I mean, come on. How many like that? Nobody likes that, but that's what happened. And so he had to stay in love and be kind, but he got up under that impression is that because the disciples said, don't you care that we perish?
Right.
And perish means that we're being destroyed. It pictures something that's being undone, unraveled, coming apart, or coming to pieces.
Right.
So they were saying, don't you care, not that the storm is doing this, don't you care that we are falling to pieces?
That we're falling apart, exactly.
We are falling to pieces
and
here.
And so many people are today.
Yeah, because we dealt with this without the word.
Right.
We tried it our own way. We based it on the fact we're fishermen. We know how to handle it. We can figure it out. Mm-hmm. We don't need God. And so we tried it our own way.
Mm-hmm.
And now don't you care that our way didn't work? You know, there's a way that seems right to a man.
Right.
But in the end, it leads to what?
Destruction
and death.
Right.
So that's what was happening here.
Right.
They were on their way to death, and they finally wake him up, you know, yanked him up, poor guy, out of his sleep, and said, hello.
Right.
You know, we're falling to pieces here. Aren't you going to be God?
Care. Right.
Be the master and do something, even though he just poured faith into them.
Right, exactly.
He had just poured faith into them. I think they said the
Not
Sea of Galilee is like 5 miles across.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like a week's journey.
Right. It was just
it
maybe
wasn't
an
like
hour
they heard
ago.
It 3 weeks ago.
Maybe an hour
I know
ago,
it was
some
like
previous.
The message on Sunday morning, and here it is Sunday night, and they're falling apart.
Right, exactly.
Be doers of the word.
Right.
Carest thou not? Don't you have any care inside of you for us? That's what it means.
Yeah.
Don't you have any care in that body of yours for us?
Yeah.
So the rebuke. Do you want to talk about that?
What?
How he stood up and he rebuked.
Oh, it wasn't very nice. We'll just put it that way. But
it's a conversation.
Yeah.
When you because sometimes we think
to the storm we're talking
to
about
the
here.
Storm. Like sometimes you think
wind.
We you know rebuke something. So we'll say, I rebuke you, wind.
Right.
I rebuke you, sickness.
Right.
But actually, when you look it up, and I thought it was very eye-opening, I'm like, that'll change how I handle things.
Right.
But it says it's a series of words meant to chide, humiliate, embarrass, dishonor, and verbally assault.
Right.
He had a conversation with the demonic force.
Right.
He didn't just say, I rebuke you.
Right.
He had a conversation in which he assaulted them verbally.
Right.
Embarrassed them.
Right.
Dishonored them.
Right.
Humiliated that spirit out there.
Right.
With his words.
Right.
That's what the word will do. It'll tear down.
Right.
Everything that comes against you, because hell knows it's already defeated.
Right.
And so he rebuked the storm, which is actually the spirit being
throwing
the waves.
Right. The spirit behind it.
And it said he totally humiliated them.
Right.
Dishonored them, you know, embarrassed them in front
right.
of hell and,
right.
and the devil, obviously.
Right.
And then it said, you know, because the Bible says in James 4:7, submit yourself therefore to God.
Resist the devil.
And right. he will flee from you. And that word flee means to move your feet as fast as you can.
Right.
To run is in terror. So that's what happened here.
Right.
He embarrassed them.
Right.
And rebuked them, had
right.
a conversation with them. Mm-hmm. And they got terrified.
Right.
And so, and it says, and when the wind ceased, when everything ceased.
Immediately, right.
The waves, that ceased means to grow weary. It's a picture of one who is exhausted from the fight, so he just gives up.
Gave up.
So
right.
you have to picture, this is the devil.
Right.
This is the devil. These are demonic, a demonic
entities.
Attack. There
right.
are demonic attacks set forth to derail you from what God's called you to
right.
do. Like a coronavirus, when God's declared things over you for 2020, the storm, the wind, the waves
right.
has no authority over the word he spoke to you on the shore when
right.
all was calm.
Right.
And it says the sea, the waves basically got weary.
Right.
They got weary of this fight. And
right.
then it says they were so tired and exhausted that they just gave
they
up.
They just took off.
So
right.
that's what happened with the waves. It was like, okay, put them down. We're done.
Right.
And they walked, just drop the
right.
waves, boys. We
right.
lost. Let's go.
Right.
Didn't work.
Right.
You know, that's the picture of what's happening
yeah.
here. They were so embarrassed.
Yeah. And the thing
humiliated.
About, yeah. And
fools.
What's so important about this, and see, for those of you who haven't been tuning in with us or haven't been coming to church on midweek services, we have been talking about the believer's
authority. Come on.
The
and
authority
he's in us.
Of the believer.
Jesus is not just in
and,
our boat. He's in
yeah,
us.
Yeah. And there are sometimes,
right.
not in, now hear what I'm saying. Not everything, every problem you deal with has got a devil behind it.
No,
let's just clarify
everything.
That. Let's not get super spiritual. But there are situations where there are demonic presence,
right.
Demonic entities
that
are behind
it.
Things.
Hell is behind
yeah.
it.
And sometimes if you don't know your authority, it don't matter what you say, you've got to use your authority to stop the situation.
Right.
So when Jesus, like I say, spoke to the wind
right.
in the situation, he was actually speaking to the entity to stop
the
waves,
wind.
Right,
yeah,
and all that stuff.
He dealt with the problem,
he
not
dealt
the waves
with the root
the wind.
Of the issue.
Right.
Exactly. And
right.
fear right now,
yeah.
fear is the root of the issue in the world right now. It's not the coronavirus. Fear is using the coronavirus because God has not given us a spirit of
Amen.
Fear. And fear is an entity. Fear is a
right.
spirit. And see, people have got to not give into the spirit. They've got to get into faith in this situation. Super, super
yeah,
important.
Yeah, because if you recognize through this story, fear will deal with the symptoms.
Yep.
Faith will deal with the source.
Right, right.
So when you get into fear, you start dealing with the symptoms. You get panic over what could happen, my money, my
right.
my body, my kids are home from school. What if I hurt them because I'm so stressed out? You know, all this stupid stuff going on. Well, grace be
she
to you
that.
In Jesus' name. No, you won't hurt them. But, you know, you put them in their room. You lock
right.
them up in their room. You know, there's time out in homeschooling. But anyway, and a lot of homeschoolers believe in the old-fashioned discipline, not standing in the corner.
Yeah,
but that's not what this is about down. Either. You know,
yeah.
feel free to discipline. But
right.
anyway, but fear deals with the symptoms. Fear, panic. At the moment, because fear is looking at the symptoms of it, and
right.
faith will deal with the source
the
of it,
source.
Which is what Jesus did. As
right.
he is,
right.
so are we. We got to see what's behind it. Don't get so worked up with the news every day
right.
and the different reports every day
yep.
and the different waves that come day after day. Don't get caught up in those.
Right.
What is the source of them? And as believers,
right.
if Jesus is in us, the right thing is to have a conversation with hell.
Right.
You
and
know,
saying, not my house.
Exactly. Paul, I know, and all, and Jesus, I know. Who are you? Oh, you know
right,
who I am.
Right.
Oh, you
right.
know who I am. And
right.
so, and then when he said to the waves, you know, peace be still, this is how we handle it. In the original, what that means is, shh, that's enough.
Right, enough.
Just like a kid that throws a tantrum.
Right.
The devil was throwing a tantrum.
Mm-hmm.
The storm didn't come because of where they were. The storm came because of where they were going.
Right.
It's not because of where you are. It's because of where you're going. And a storm doesn't mean you've missed God.
Right. And God's got great plans for everybody.
It's
greatness
still,
inside of us. Still.
Still. His word still stands.
Right.
But he looked at the storm just like he would look at a kid throwing a fit, throwing
right.
a tantrum. They throw themselves on the floor. They kick, they scream, they roll, they throw things at you, they scream at you. And finally you look at him and go, shh, that's enough.
Enough.
It's that right. mom look.
No more. Everybody knows the mom look.
That's enough. And so that's what happened. Right. He didn't yell at that. Peace.
Right.
He was just basically saying, shh, that's enough.
No more.
You're done.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So now look at how he also addresses his disciples. Moving on to verse 40, he says this. He said to his, so this is after everything calmed down.
Right.
Right. And then he said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?
Yeah.
Now, we got to see what's really happening here. Jesus was not happy that they woke him up.
Right.
Okay, he didn't get up as a grouch. Let's all clarify that.
Right.
He was not happy that the situation he was awoken to was full of fear.
Right.
And see, he says, why are you so afraid? See, Jesus has already been with them for, and it hasn't been very long. It's just a short amount of time that they've been disciples.
Right.
But they still should have known by now everything's going to be okay. And he says, do you still have no faith?
Right.
And see, he's challenging them because of this. And this is a challenge to all of us here right now. You, me, everybody that's watching right now. It's a challenge. Where's our faith? Because when he says, do you not have any faith by now? He says, you ought to have faith to get through this right now. You shouldn't be bugging me.
You have the faith.
You have the faith to deal with the storm itself.
Right. I just poured it into you.
Exactly.
Faith came when I taught you.
Exactly.
So you have faith. It is in there.
Right.
So basically he said, you're being a coward. Why are you being cowards?
Exactly.
That's the original.
Yeah,
I know that's kind of painful, but
that's what he's saying.
Why are you being a coward when you have faith? It's in your possession. Why didn't you just use it?
Right.
And you, like with Jesus, you know, he wasn't even standing up and rebuking anything for himself.
Right.
He did it for them.
Right.
He didn't need to reassure and confess again.
Right.
He rebuked the storm or the entity or the personality for them,
for the
to bring
disciples.
Them peace, because they were trying to use panic and fear and all this to handle it. And that's not what delivered them. What delivered them was the word of God.
Right.
The word is what delivered them, not their panic and their fear, which made it worse.
Right.
The word is what delivered him. And so he said, you guys are being cowards because, first of all, I'm with you and I'm the word. I'm the Bible. You know, I'm the word.
And look at me. I'm sleeping. I'm relaxing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just, you know, like Psalms 91.
Exactly.
He's doing it.
That you're in the secret place of the Most High. So they had their Bible with them. They just didn't open it.
Right.
Yep. And how many of us as believers, we enter into something and we switch over to the natural and the Bible's the last place we go.
Right. Yeah. People say, oh, we better pray about this now. And people are like, oh, has it come to that?
Right.
That would be the first thing that we're doing.
Yeah. Their Bible was right there on a pillow.
Right.
And they just chose not to open it. And Jesus is like, you're cowards.
Right.
I gave you word.
Right.
Back there, and you could have handled this.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now let me say something here, and it's not saying this in the Bible, but this is just my insight, and I could be totally wrong on this, but see, we as people, as believers, we can either get into faith or we can get into fear. And whatever we get into, we give power to. So we can get into faith and give power, or we can get into fear and give power.
Right.
Has to do with our authority. Now, you got to think about this. Jesus was the only one that was checked out because he was sleeping. All the rest of the disciples were freaking out. And I guarantee you, everybody else in all the rest of the boats were freaking out also. So you have all this fear from everybody. Every single person is in fear, which to me personally made the storm stronger. They kept getting into fear. More fear was spreading. Fear spread like wildfire. And it empowered the storm to get stronger and stronger and stronger.
Right.
But notice what happened when one person got in faith.
Yeah.
One person in faith overrode all the fear that was out there.
Helped everybody.
Yep.
Sometimes you have to step out in your faith,
exactly.
Not because you have to do it, but because people around you are falling to pieces.
Exactly.
And you have to be the light. You have to take the word. Somebody has to be a Christian.
Somebody's
during this
gotta stand
crap
up.
And stand up and act on the word and speak the word, because it was the spoken word that dealt with this. Open our mouth, life and death in the power of our tongue, and speak to something and then get into rest.
Right.
But be a help to someone else. Mm-hmm. Encourage someone else like Jesus. He did it for them.
Right.
He did it for them.
Right.
And not for himself. And I think it's interesting because obviously the devil knew that the word was with them.
Right.
He knew they had the Bible with them.
Right.
He was just hoping they didn't know it.
Right.
And obviously they didn't.
Yeah.
But so that's why the storm came. He's trying to pull out of you what he knows is in you.
Right.
and to see if you'll respond. Because like you said, you know, faith will draw the things of God. Fear will repel them.
Right.
And so he's waiting to see what we're going to do, whether it's isolated for 2 weeks or 4 weeks or whatever. In Jesus' name, it won't be months. And he's waiting to see how we handle that.
Right.
Even though we have the word in us, he's coming for the word.
The enemy,
he comes immediately to steal the word.
But that's what I love about this is Jesus was so upset because he knew that they already had within them enough to deal with the situation that was going on around them.
Yep.
And see, so many people are calling on God, and I've heard it. I've watched the videos. I've heard pastors. I've heard people all over the internet. You know what they're doing? They're all saying, God, get rid of this virus. God, do this. God, would you stop this? God, would you please intervene? God, would you whatever? And God is going, would you take care of the situation? I've already put it in you to deal with the situation. Be the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. Be the church. Rise up like Jesus did and shine in this world
Now's
of darkness.
Time.
Now is the time to rise up as the church.
And there's no condemnation. I mean, we've all done that. You know, because we've all faced different storms.
Right.
I mean, what's come in my life hasn't come in your life, and vice versa. And, you know, I'm not going to tell you or condemn how you responded, but it's a perfect opportunity to just get in the Word, let the Word feed our faith.
Right.
Check out where you're at, and so encourage each other. Like, come on, come on, we're Christian. Come on, get your mouth on it.
Right.
No, let's remind each other of the promises of God through the internet, through social media. Let's stop posting crap. Let's stop posting the studies. Let's stop posting how many's died. And let's post things that encourages one another in the Lord, speaks faith to one another, corrects in love. Now, get your mouth back over here. You know, that's what we should be taking advantage of, getting the word out there. In spite of all this bad news.
Right. It's kind of like what we're even doing right now. You know, when the Bible says in Hebrews, don't forsake the assembling of the saints, which is talking about church.
Right.
So if you don't go to church on a regular basis, you should. But it says why? It says that we can encourage one another. We can build one another up, and we can even challenge one another and say, you know what? The God that's in you is bigger than anything in the world that's coming against you, including this virus, including the economy, including jobs and everything. Remember, your job is not your source. The government. Government is not your source. God is our source, and we will get through this in Jesus' name quicker than most people realize. I believe that with all of my heart.
And I like at the end there when the disciples said, you know, who is this man?
Right, exactly.
That even the wind and the waves obey him. What the stink? Who is this person?
Right.
And when you look up that obey, it means to attend to or obey. It pictures one in a subordinate position. Who listens to a commanding voice or officer that exercises their vocal authority over him. So it's a servant. It's someone that serves someone else who knows that they are not the highest power.
Right.
They're subordinate to someone else. And so when it says they obeyed him, it's because they recognize that Jesus has authority over me. The word has authority. We got to settle that. They had no option. And, you know, the devil knows who's boss.
Right.
And he knows that he isn't, and he knows who gets the last word.
Right.
He knows who gets the last word, and he knows that he's got to bow his knee to the word of God. And Jesus is in us. So when we speak the word, it's like Jesus is speaking, and the storm has to settle.
Right.
Because it's subordinate to the word of God.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Can I just read this one psalm, and then you can wrap it or do it. Psalm 89:9 in the Passion. I really like it because Jesus lives in us. And so listen to this. Scripture based on the fact that we are seated with him in heavenly places. We have all heaven behind us. And when we speak, it's the word. It's Jesus speaking. But this is what it says in Psalm 89:9. It says, you rule over oceans and the swelling seas.
Right.
It says, when their stormy waves rise up, you speak and they lie still.
Yep.
And we have Jesus
exactly
in us. So you rule over the storms in your life. And when you speak, it lies still. That's so awesome. I love that verse, Old Testament. But it's good because that Jesus that this is talking about lives in me. So when I speak his word, the storm must lie still.
Right. And see, that just goes back to confession, life and death are in the power of the tongue.
Right.
And see, it's so important. See, a lot of people, they say, yeah, but Jesus did this. Jesus did this. Jesus spoke to the winds. But see, the thing about it is we are now his hands.
Yeah,
we are his feet. We are his mouthpiece with his authority down here. And like I said, we have got to speak to our situations. In our house, like I said, we're not concerned at all. We say no sickness, no disease at our house. You know, we're fine. There is no problem.
I just
want
to go shopping. I'm frustrated that I can't go to the mall.
Yeah.
But, you know, and online stuff could get a little bit out of hand.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah. And you can't, you have to live life just as if everything is going to be okay.
Right.
Now I'm going to say something that might make a few people upset, but don't judge me because of where I'm at or because of where we are at. But see, there's people right now, they're canceling things for the next year. They're canceling stuff. They're even looking into 2021. They're forgetting they're canceling stuff. We just booked a cruise. Mm-hmm. We just, what, 2 days ago?
Yeah, we had
we just
awesome
booked
deal.
A cruise 2 days ago. You know why? Because everybody's freaking out so much. The prices are so low. We just booked a cruise, and we are expecting to go on it in Jesus' name.
It's a good time to invest.
Exactly.
It's a good time to invest. Don't panic. Buy stocks.
Yeah.
Because it's going to turn around.
It's all going to go up in Jesus'
name. It's going to turn around. Psalm 107 or 104.7. Let me just do this in the Good News Translation. It says, when you rebuked the waters, they fled. So it's just like God is speaking to us. Again, Jesus is in us. When you rebuked the water, when you had a conversation,
right.
It fled.
Right.
Its little feet took off and Terah gave up. It quit the fight. It was exhausted.
Right.
It said they rushed away when they heard the sound of your command.
Right. Right.
They rushed away.
Right.
What authority we have. It's not a time to panic.
Yeah, it's the same thing that like Jesus said in John 14, 12, when he said, the same things that I did,
right.
You're going to do also.
Right.
And he was talking about the miracles. You know what? Speaking to the wind, the waves, this that's a miracle what took place. And Jesus said, the same things I did because I live in you. My power in you is greater than what's out there in the world. You need to do the same thing that I did.
Right.
So I want to encourage you, get your mouth against what's coming against us.
Speak
now,
to it.
Yeah, now before we finish this off, I need to encourage you about this.
Right.
In the next chapter. Now this next chapter, the Bible separates a lot of things. This is just going right on. Because remember, the beginning was go to the other side. Mm-hmm. Remember? Go to the other side. Well, see, when they finally got to the other side, when the wind calmed down, they got to the other side. And I'm not going to read it all for time's sake, but for those of you who will read in chapter 5, they got to the other side, and what happened when they got to the other side?
They were met by the devil. They just came through the devil, and now they're met with him again as soon as they step off.
Yeah, and they got to the other side, was met by a man who was possessed by many demons.
Or two men,
depending on what version
Matthew,
you're reading.
There was two, but there was one that was more powerful.
Right.
That's the one they focused on in Mark.
Right, but the thing about it is this. When they got there, this devil, this guy was so possessed that they couldn't keep him chained down.
Right.
They couldn't keep him bound.
They couldn't keep his clothes on.
Yeah, this guy also was so tormented that he cut himself and he screamed on a regular basis through the night.
Yeah.
This guy was about as possessed as a person could get. This guy was.
Right.
Now you got to see what's going on here. Jesus said just earlier, let's go to the other side.
Ministry.
Okay, but you
do.
Know what? When God gives you a word, do you know the devil hears that too? And the devil knew we can't let Jesus get to the other side because if he gets to the other side, he's going to be able to deliver this guy that's possessed by the devil. We can't let that happen.
Mm-hmm.
We can't let this guy get delivered because if he gets delivered, it's going to be a great thing.
Yep.
And so the thing about it was the devil tried to take him out in the storm. Because he knew if they get to the other side, this other guy is going to get helped also.
Right.
And so what I want to encourage
the whole region, because they were afraid to go by there.
Yeah.
They wouldn't go down that road.
Yeah.
The whole region stayed away from two guys.
This area.
It terrified them.
Right, because it was so bad.
So life was upheavaled in the whole region.
Right.
Over two devils or a multitude of devils running around in these two men.
Right.
So it was affecting more than just them.
Exactly.
And they wanted to be disciples. And Jesus said, no, go tell what I've did. I mean, they evangelized. They went out and they affected more people.
Exactly.
You know, you reach one, they reach 10, they reach 100. And the storm didn't change the assignment.
The assignment, exactly.
The appointment. It doesn't matter what you're going through or we're going through as a nation right now or a world.
Right.
It's a temporary bleep. It's a small part of our life, but it's not our life.
Exactly.
It's a small paragraph in a chapter, but it's not the whole chapter. It's not the whole book. And whatever you've been assigned to, you're still assigned to.
Exactly.
It's not time to quit and give up. Don't grow weary in well-doing because you will reap if you don't quit.
Right. And see, the thing that I love about this is this. There is a purpose for you to get through this storm that we're in right now.
Yep.
Right now, what's going on in the world right now and everybody freaking out, the storm that's happening in the world, you've got to understand that storm is trying to take you out. The reason why is because there are people on the other side of this storm that need you to be the church, that needs you to rise up, that needs you to be bold in your faith, to get through this storm. Right. So they can be delivered on the other side of this storm.
Yep. You got to rest.
And it's so important that you understand. We're getting through this storm because there's other people that need you and there's other people that need us.
Right.
And so it's
we're gonna
a lot
make
bigger.
It. Yeah. In Jesus' name, this is not the end of the world.
Right. It is a
it's
lot
bigger.
It's
just a bleep and, you know, it's just, it's going to pass.
Right.
And it's just a season and we're strong as Americans and we're going to get through this.
Amen.
And so we're going to keep talking social media.
Right.
You can reach us too on Facebook. If you just have a prayer request or you want to talk to us, we could use some encouraging sometimes too. No, I'm just kidding. but if you want to reach out to us or talk to us, you know, some people have texted us. And so it's nice to know that we're family.
Right.
And we can encourage one another in the Lord. And even though we're physically apart, we're not spiritually apart.
Yes.
And we've got one another on our heart and on our mind. And so that's important that we stay connected.
Right.
And build one another up. If you're struggling, if you're having a moment, reach out to someone in your body of believers that you know, that you know is a faith person and get them to agree with you. Don't cry and whine about the problem.
Right.
Or what about my money, my stocks, my job? No, forget that. God knows what you have need of. He knows where you are. He said, seek first him.
Right.
So open your Bible. Don't leave him laying on the pillow and get some faith about you and know that God is still on the throne and we are getting through this and the world is not over.
Right.
It's not the end. This ain't the tribulation or something.
Yeah. Let me tell you something that is really, really amazing. This, what we're teaching right now, actually in our men's group in February, so the very beginning of February, so the first Tuesday of every month at 6:30, the men get together from both branches at Forgiven Church. And when I was praying about what message to share with the men of armor, all reliable men of righteousness, was this. And the thing about it was, and I was wondering why, I'm like, what do you mean, Lord? So the very beginning of February, I was teaching this to our men of armor, the men ought to be leading, and he said, you need to understand in a year of harvest, because 2020 is a year of harvest. And the Lord shared this with me, and he said, you need to prepare people that storms are still going to come in 2020. And that you need to be prepared for when the storms come, not to take your harvest out. I had no idea how prophetic this was. When I shared this with the men in the beginning of February, that here we are, just a little over a month later, going through what we're going through right now. It was, I mean, when the Lord shared this with me, I'm like, man, thank God that you told us to be full of faith that we're going to get through this storm. So I had no idea how prophetic that was at the
God
very beginning
knows,
of February.
So after he said it's a year of harvest.
Yeah.
Then he gave you that.
Absolutely.
So God's not caught off guard. Jesus wasn't in the boat. And
Amen.
The devil's just sneaky. He doesn't play fair.
Nope.
And but the word still works. So that's
Amen.
The bottom line. And it doesn't change who he is in our life. It changes around the world.
Right.
The effect it has on people. But if he's your Lord before the storm, he's still the same Jesus. And
in
his word
storm,
still works in the storm.
Amen.
Amen.
Why don't you pray for the people and then we'll go after that. Thank you.
Father, we just come to you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you so much
for
an opportunity to come together. We are so grateful for technology. God, that
you
gave this to us for this season. God, that you've made it available that we could still reach one another. We could stay in touch. That we
don't
have to be totally isolated from one another, but we have the blessing
to
be able to freely reach out to one another and encourage one another in the Lord and be an example to one another. So Father, I thank you for that first and foremost, because that wisdom is from you. God, I thank you so much for the word that's gone forth, that faith was in the word, not condemnation, not fear, not feeling like I'm not worthy. Oh my gosh, I've screwed up. No, faith came with the word. And God, I thank you that anyone that was, dwindling or struggling in their faith, God, that the word that came forth just spoke to their spirit, our spirit to their spirit, the Holy Spirit just ministered to us and faith just is being built up and encouraged. The fire is being stoked again. You know, stir up the fire, stir up the gift that's in you, stir up the faith that's in you. That's our job to do. And I think that we've stirred it up with one another today.
Yes.
And we've ignited something again that maybe has died in other people. And God, I thank you that this is an opportunity for the Holy Spirit, for you to just minister and us to grow to a deeper level with you, to be more dependent on you, to look to you more strongly instead of taking things for granted. Now we're in a place, God, some of us that haven't needed you, quote unquote. Now people are seeing they need you.
Right.
I thank you that it's drawing people to you like never before. People that have wandered away.
Yes.
God, people have left the faith. People have been condemned or the enemy has stolen them away. I thank you right
Bring
now.
Them
we
back.
Just call them back in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Anyone listening to the sound of our voice that was here once and left for whatever reason because the enemy got in and robbed them.
Yeah.
I thank you, God, that by your spirit, because of this storm, this pressure, you're pulling them back into the kingdom. You're pulling them back into their faith. You're pulling them back into relationship, God. You're using what was meant for evil. You are turning it for the good of people, of your people that you love so much. So we thank you for restoration, wholeness, peace, faith, God, like never before, that we're coming on the other side. We're coming out stronger than what we went in. We thought we had it together before.
Right.
God, I thank you that the enemy doesn't know what he's going to be up against when we hit the shore on the other side. God, he has no idea what we're going to be like. An army that's undefeatable, an army who knows their God. And just like Paul said, I believe that which was spoken unto me. None of these things move me. It will be even as it was spoken.
Said,
Job said, I know my Redeemer lives. So we thank you, God, that you live. You're alive. You're well.
Yes.
You're carrying us through.
Yes.
And we're coming out on the other side looking more like you. We love you so much. We thank you for every person listening, that every person that will listen. Thank you for the peace of God flooding their home, their bodies, their mind, their sleep, that all their provisions are met, God, that you supply all of their needs in spite of what's going on, that there's plenty of toilet paper for everybody around the world, God, because you care about toilet paper. We love you so much. You're good. You're faithful. The restoring, redeeming Jesus. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, don't. We got about five more minutes here. Zach's got another song, but we also want to give everybody an opportunity to give. But first, before that, I just wanted to say this. You know, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, man, today is your day. I want to encourage you, make sure you call upon the name of the Lord. If you don't know if you died today, if you'd go to heaven and spend eternity with Jesus, I encourage you today, make sure you call upon the name of the Lord today in Jesus' name.
Open arms.
Yeah.
Open arms. Yeah.
So I just wanted to also go through the scripture really quick. If we put that on the screen for the giving, and then the gentlemen Zach and Sam are going to sing another song.
That we're so proud of.
2 Corinthians chapter 9 says this: Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you've decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And here we go, verse 8, and God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, even right now, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work.
There's never a season that the word doesn't work.
Flu
season, virus season, there's never a season that the word does not work.
Right. So I want to encourage you right now. We still are going off of tithes and offerings and giving. Yeah. And so you can go to our website. You can go to our giving tab. You can donate online right now. Hit the donate button. It's all safe. Or if you want, I know a lot of people, they just mail their checks in. If you want to be able to do that, you can do that also. And so we just want to really encourage you to be able to just step out in faith. And also people that are in town, if you want to stop by our Dropbox, we do have a Dropbox at our office. That is a safe, secure thing that goes into the safe.
We want to get it in the ground. Now's not the time to pull back with our seed. Now's the time we're sowing for what lies ahead.
Exactly.
You know, God's taken us somewhere. It is a year of harvest. And so we want to keep our seed in the ground. Don't hoard it.
Right.
Just because the government tells us we got to be home.
Right.
We want seed in the ground.
Right.
And so we want to be faithful with that.
Right.
And so mail it in. Put it in the little box or go to
forgivenonline.org. Right.
Hit the tab. Our address, I think, is there, too,
Give
for the
it,
church
right.
address.
Right.
If you don't have an envelope, our address is on there.
Right.
Get it in the ground so we can continue to pray over it and agree with you for your breakthrough.
Yes.
Don't pull back from God now.
Yeah, and we are definitely agreeing with that. And
Amen.
So remember, as we were singing or as we were going through this today, Jesus is in your boat.
Yeah, not alone.
You're never alone. Jesus is in your boat.
Amen.
Another song that Zach wrote, Never Alone.
this life brings trials, though this road seems long, I will trust the word you say. Lord, you will never leave. Your spirit's here in me. You are the one who guides my way. You are my confidence. You are my second chance. You are the one who never lets me go. And when my strength is gone, I feel you holding on. Lord, you are with me. I'm never alone. And if I lose my way, Lord, I will seek your face, for I know you'll lead me home. You are my confidence. You are my second chance. You are the one who never lets me go. In the struggle, in the heartache, I know you're here. In the sorrow, in the grieving, in the healing, I know you're here.
Forsake you, right? Let's definitely get to the other side of this.